Hello. Hello, everybody. How you doing? Nice to see you. Mark here. The sun's gone out, so I'm a bit dingy, but we'll be starting in just a second. Today, we're mastering metaphors. Somebody last week mentioned metaphors. They said they wanted a whole session on them. So that's what we're doing this week. Come on in, join us. We'll be starting in about 3 minutes, just under 3 minutes. If you're watching this on the pre-record, feel free to move forward a little bit. I'm looking forward to working with you guys today. Okay, how are we doing? Hello, nice to see you guys. Hello, thank you guys so much for joining me this morning. We're focusing on metaphors. Hey Aoife, lovely to see you. Cool, nice to see you. I'm really glad you're enjoying the sessions. We will be starting in just about 1 minute's time. You're going to need a pen and a piece of paper. Some of the activities are a little bit quicker this time around. I was kind of set. I got up early this morning to kind of like check it all works. So yeah, I'm looking forward to it, to going through everything today. And we're going to hearing a poem to start off with as well. Good to see you guys. 30 seconds. Won't you come on over and stop making a fool out of me? I want you to come over back to me. Okay, right. Hello. Good to see you all. How are you doing today? Goodness me. It's been a roller coaster these last few weeks, hasn't it? Hello. Nice to see you guys coming back. It means a lot to me. People are popping back here. Before we go any further, I just thought I'd say thank you, to everyone that sent me work, everybody that's emailed me or messaged me, asking questions or saying that the workshops have been useful. That's really great. Cool, Anthony. Absolutely. You're very welcome to join us. I've already woken up funny day. You know me for some great rap battles. Yeah, absolutely. My name is Mark. I'm a poet. I used to be an English teacher for 5 years. I kind of specialized, I suppose, in helping people create things creatively. That's what I was really interested in. And I used to write poetry and stuff, and I started becoming a full-time poet and performer, and I've kind of done a fair bit of rap battling. You can check out any of that online. I went to the Philippines and battled a guy called Looney. That was pretty cool. And at the moment, I'm just writing lots of new poems and books and things, and I'm in the house, and I just thought, maybe I could be of use, right? And maybe I could help us think about language a bit at the moment, because I love writing and sharing what I know about writing or what I'm learning about writing, because I kind of think we're always learning. And we thought maybe we could do that together. So it's really good to see you guys here today. You're going to need like a pen and a piece of paper, and you're going to need to be like ready and raring to go. If you know nothing about what we're talking about today, that's totally fine. If you know it really well, that's great as well. Like, this is the idea, is that we're going to kind of get some share some stuff, and we're going to really get the understanding of metaphors and why metaphors are useful. I use metaphors all the time in my work. I've got a poem called Keith, where I use a bunch of them. I'm going to kind of talk to us a bit about later on. The most important thing in relation to metaphors and everything we produce today, the number one rule for me, which I've mentioned, I think, in my very first session, and some of this will come back to the very first session we ran, is that with metaphors and with everything else, originality is kind of the most important thing. All right. So metaphors are when we say that something is something else. So, for example, we might say that the sun is a burning meatball. And the moment we say the sun is a meatball, I mean, burning is kind of accurate, but meatball, we enter into the realms of metaphor. It's when we kind of link two things in a way where there is some truth in it, but it's done for poetic effect, and the audience has to kind of draw the link between the two images, right? It's not completely clear, and it's an artistic interpretation that we're asking to make. So metaphors, the important thing with originality is we try and say come up with metaphors that are original and are different and not the same as everyone else. And today's workshop is going to hopefully move you into creating metaphors that are original, that are going to make your writing really pop. I'm going to start it out by just reading a poem, if it's all right, that has like some really good metaphors within it. And we're going to look at the metaphors within that. So I thought I would read you guys Still I Rise by Maya Angelou. I don't know how you guys are feeling, seeing what's going on over in the US. I've got a podcast series called Mark Can't Rap, where I've worked with a lot of different rappers, like artists across the UK. And I don't really feel like the racial inequalities that exist in America are completely absent within the UK. I think we have a lot of issues there as well. And I think it might be good for us to kind of, maybe not here, my writing for the day, but maybe here's somebody else's writing at this point in time. So it goes like this. Still I rise. You may write me down in history with your bitter, twisted lies. You may trod me in the very dirt, but still like dust, I'll rise. Does my sassiness upset you? Why are you beset with gloom? Because I walk like I've got oil wells pumping in my living room. Just like moons and like suns, with the certainty of tides. Just like hopes springing high, still I'll rise. Did you want to see me broken, bowed head and lowered eyes, shoulders falling down like teardrops, weakened by my soulful cries? Does my haughtiness offend you? Don't you take it awful hard, because I laugh like I've got gold mines digging in my own backyard. You may shoot me with your words. You may cut me with your eyes. You may kill me with your hatefulness, but still like air, I'll rise. Does my sexiness upset you? Does it come as a surprise that I dance like I've got diamonds at the meeting of my thighs? Out of the huts of history's shame, I rise. Up from a past that's rooted in pain, I rise. I'm a black ocean, leaping and wide, welling and swelling, I bear in the tide. Leaving behind nights of terror and fear, I rise. Into a daybreak that's wondrously clear, I rise. Bringing the gifts that my ancestors gave, I am the dream and the hopes of a slave. I rise, I rise, I rise. It's Maya Angelou. I think it's a really fitting piece at the moment, and I think she's a fantastic writer, but I think also we need to listen to different voices talking to us about their experiences and their struggles, and we need to pay attention. So I think it's a really good thing for us to focus on. So that was Still I Rise by Maya Angelou. Now, Maya Angelou uses some fantastic metaphor within that piece. As I said before, metaphor is when we take one thing and we say that it's the same as something else. Now, in this piece, she uses something called simile. All right. Now, I'm sure we have encountered similes before. Some of you wrote these in the earlier workshop. So in a simile, we say that something is like something else. We compare two things with the word like, or with the word as in there as well. So we might say it's as bright as the sun, or we might say it is as cold as a refrigerator. And as soon as we use the word like or as, It's different to a metaphor when we would be saying it is the sun or it is a refrigerator. She uses a lot of simile within the poem. The important thing to start with is simile is a metaphor. Okay, before we go any further, simile is a kind of metaphor. All right, metaphor is always when we're trying to compare two things with an artistic input. The idea with a metaphor is you have the thing, which is called the tenor, that is being likened to something else, which is the vehicle. So, for example, like you could say, myself, I am like air. You could say that, and the tenor being myself. You could say, here she says in the poem, I laugh like I've got gold mines. So here she's got the tenor, which is her laugh, which is the thing, and the vehicle, which is what she says it is becoming. And she's using like all the way through to link the tenor and the vehicle. She's saying she is like air. She's saying her laugh is like gold mine, like she laughs like she's got gold mines. And she's saying her shoulders, like she says in the poem, are like teardrops as well, which I think is a really lovely simile. Before we go any further, we need to acknowledge similes are metaphors. So I would like you guys to have a go at writing your own versions. I've got three starts of a simile, and I want you to come up with your own similes for these that are original, okay? So I want to have similes that no one else in the chat thread, your similes. She said, she used this, didn't she? I laugh like, I dance like, I walk like. What can you say for your similes? I laugh like what? What does your laugh sound like that could be different to anyone else's? I dance like, what could your dance be like that's not like anybody else? My dance is pretty bad. Like, I'll be honest with you, my dancing's pretty awful. And I walk like, what do you walk like? Okay, do you walk, maybe you're high status, maybe you walk with quite a high status and you describe it in that way. Maybe you walk quite low status, or somebody walks in an unusual way. This doesn't have to apply to you specifically. We're being poetic, so it can be a character you're talking about, but I want you kind of to think what you can get. Right, okay, we got one idea straight away off the bat. I laugh like a hyena. Nice. Okay, this is great. Now, I laugh like a hyena is a really, really good simile. That makes complete sense to me. I understand because I know that hyenas also laugh, right? So we've got a link. Here's the thing. I think a lot of people might think to put the word hyena because it doesn't take much to put those two words in. Can you add more description to the hyena? Can you add more language here so you're more likely to come up with a simile using the word hyena that no one else would think of? Because that's really, when you're sat down for an exam, that's really what you've got to be doing. Also, if you want to write something that's going to stick in people's mind, that's what you've got to do as well. So we've got this part, and Brandon, amazing, I love it, the hyena. But can we add more description around that hyena image so that your metaphor is going to be, your simile, which is a type of metaphor, is going to be more powerful? So again, here, like a dance like an acrobat. If suddenly we said, like, I dance like a drunken acrobat, then suddenly I'm like, oh, okay, this is it's more unlikely someone else would think what you were coming up with. I laugh like an automated voice from Google. I like it. Automated is an interesting word. I don't encounter that a lot. Remember, being original, we're definitely trying to say things that other people wouldn't think to say. I laugh like a monkey. Brilliant. I dance like an old man. I walk like an Egyptian. Cool. Now, these are great. I think I walk like an Egyptian. I mean, I've heard that song. So it's not, for me, totally original. I would like you to try and add extra language around that image of the monkey. What words can you add to this monkey to make it more likely that your simile is unlike anyone else's? Oh, Brandon. I laugh like a sly hyena stalking its prey. Suddenly, this is a much more complex simile that you're using, right? Suddenly, this is like much more exciting and unusual because you're quite sinister now. You're still laughing, but there's like an additional edge to it, and it's more likely that it's going to be a unique and original simile. Remember, when we're writing, originality, taking a risk, is more important. It's always more important. So anytime you can, if you think, is this going to be a bit weird? Put it down. Like, absolutely. Right. That's what we're here to do. Okay. I walk like I have the purpose of a proud veteran. Oh, I like the purpose of a proud veteran as well. That purpose of a proud really kind of gives me a sense of rhythm and confidence, which I think is really nice. walk like a doll in a horror film. That's pretty unique. That's a pretty unique simile. I agree. Oh, nice. I dance like a snail at the disco. Snail at the disco is a pretty good name for a band or a to be honest, it's for a children's book. I think that's a good title. Yeah, amazing. I laugh like a villain. Now, you could just have I laugh like a villain. And sometimes I think within poems, we want simple images. But what I like here, if we're being descriptive and we're making sure that we're putting our own take on things and we're being original, I laugh like a villain with a master plan. Straight away, it's less likely someone would think of putting all of that down. So it's more original. That's really, really nice. I walk like a drunken sailor drowning his sorrows. Yes, these are great. These are really, really good. Me too. This isn't even a simile. Well, it is, but like, oh no, not that one. That one is great, by the way. But I've got this one. I dance like an embarrassing dad at a wedding. Fully me. Absolutely. All the way. So these are really strong. And can you see when you commit to writing a simile, you have to just look at it and think, can I just squeeze a bit more out of it? Now, you don't always have to have like a longer, complex simile. Sometimes a really striking still simile can do wonders on its own. I'd say definitely within poetry, you can definitely do that. But I think if we're writing descriptive narratives, it's sometimes good thinking about, can one extra word or an extra idea or color sometimes, can that really kind of make my simile pop and help me give... hit the golden standard of originality. All right, cool. These are great. So we've got our similes, all right, which is a type of metaphor. That's one type. And remember, we've got, whenever we're coming up with a metaphor, it's a simple statement. We have these two things. We have a tenor. Okay, a tenor. I always liken it to like we got like opera singers trying to get into a limo. All right, so you got a tenor. All right, so someone who is something we're talking about and the vehicle, which is what we're saying that it is. All right, so so Maya Angelou says she is the tenor within her writing. She says, I'm a black ocean, she says. And that's the vehicle. That's what she says that she is. And that sounds really powerful, doesn't it? When she says that she is a black ocean, that feels like bottomless, wide, huge. There's lots of movement. There's lots of strength, and like you can't really control it. It's a really powerful, striking metaphor, and she does it just by putting the word black in there as well, which is obviously like an incredibly important part of the like some of the main themes of this poem. What she's talking about, the word black is really important within the poem. Okay, so that is a really, really effective, tight metaphor. Notice she is not using like or as in this, right? She's just saying she is that. Now, I like similes a lot, but I think personally, if you can get a metaphor and you can nail the metaphor, it's more striking. I think sometimes a simile is it's like a softer image than a metaphor. Metaphors, you've got to be pretty confident and cocky, right? You've got to go like, I'm saying this thing is this thing. I'm not saying it's like it. I'm going the full distance saying it is this. So you could say, there's a very famous poetic line, which is that the eyes are, and the vehicle was, windows to the soul, that the eyes are the windows to the soul. Now, when this line of poetry came about during the Second World War, no one had written that before. No one had really kind of like thought about that line, but that line was so powerful, we still refer to it now. It's a very powerful metaphor that exists. Then we think about that, don't we? And I think that's because there's truth in it, which we'll come to in a bit, but eyes are being windows to the soul. That's really powerful, and it's really kind of lasted well. And that's the tenor being the eyes and the vehicle being the windows to the soul. Love as the tenor is a really kind of well-known metaphor that love is blind. Right. And we've just taken the thing in real life and then we've got the vehicle over here. Right. Now, those are straightforward metaphors. I'm going to give you three of these and see if you can have a go at them. All right. So my eyes. What can you say the eyes are? You're not allowed to say that the eyes are windows to the soul. But once again, we're thinking about our originality. We're trying to make sure that we push a metaphor that's really unique and different. I've used this eyes one a lot. So if you can come up with something like, oh, jeez. I mean, just going to come back. That's amazing, Callum, by the way. I've just seen that on the thread. Yeah. Oh, no, I laugh like a tyrant, but I really don't mind. Great. These are great. So my eyes are, my thoughts are, And then I've got like a more complex metaphor here. The books left in the rain were, what were they? Books that have been left out in the rain. What can you say that they were that would be a metaphor? That's a real tricky one. See if you can do. But what can you say your eyes are? What can you say your thoughts are? Okay, that no one else on the thread would think to say that it is, that feels really unique and original. Remember, you can be short, can be long, but the important thing is no one else would think to combine those ideas. All right, so give it some thought as you're going. As we're doing this, like a super little trick you can use with your metaphors, a writer called Ginsberg used to use this. It's called an eyeball kick. I use these quite a bit. It's when you take a dictionary and you open the dictionary on two random words, two random pages, and you just see what you get. I mean, I do scan slightly, and I find two different words from that, and I say that those things are, those two things are then, like, say, would, how does that sit as a metaphor? So I might go, all right, determined stones. That's what I get from just grabbing a book randomly and choosing two things. My eyes are his eyes were determined stones. It's all right. I think it's pretty good. I think we could like tweak it a little bit. But if you're stuck at any point and you've got a dictionary lying around the house today, grab it. You'd be surprised. Opening two random pages can come up with some pretty cool stuff. My eyes are this is somehow with a simile. Like we said before, simile is a type of metaphor, so that's totally fine. But we're going to try what we can to kind of push it into full metaphor. We're not going to say it is something as something or it's like something. We're going to say it is. My eyes are what? I might say my eyes are sloppy goldfish bowls. That's what I would say. And that would be my metaphor. My eyes are sloppy goldfish bowls today. But you've got much better ideas. So, oh. Hmm. Pretty creepy, but pretty nice. My eyes are the filter to my deepest, darkest thoughts. Great. I love it. Really, really nice. I like a filter. I don't really get that very much. Deepest, darkest thoughts. Do you know what? Deepest, darkest, I get sometimes. I think we might be able to find a way that we can even push that because I think it is a kind of words that I often do find together. But I like it a lot, Callum. I think that's cool. Okay, I like this. My eyes are brighter than the, I imagine this might be the moon and stars combined. I like it. I think it's good. Although we're kind of using brighter than, I'd like to say it says, it is the moon and stars combined. I think would be a more clear metaphor, but I think it's really nice. But this is great, guys. Okay, I like that. My eyes are greedy, like a child at a party. Great. Jill, this is really, really nice. I like it. It's a really unique image. With a metaphor, unlike a simile, we don't use the word like. So you can actually, what's kind of cool is you can go, my eyes are greedy children at a party, right? Notice we can just cut those extra words. They're not important. And as soon as you go, my eyes are greedy children at a party, I think it is a more confident, ambitious way of presenting that image than saying my eyes are greedy like a child at a party. I think my eyes are a greedy child at the party. That's a pretty cool line. I would quite like to steal that personally. I think that's a nice line. My eyes are the secrets to my dreams. Nice. My thoughts are a tornado of mixed emotions and wandering souls. Oh, yeah, fantastic. There's a lot going on in there. These are great. My eyes are the jewels to my crown. Lovely, lovely, lovely. So we've got these great things for eyes. This is good. I'm still going to give you a little bit of time. The books left in the rain is really tricky. This is when we're taking an object. We might want to go with something short. I would say the books left in the rain, I would go with like drenched marshmallows. All right. I might say that. The books left in the rain were drenched marshmallows. I might say that. And that feels like I can picture that they're squishy and pretty minging, right? And really, the only part of metaphor is the word marshmallows. All right. But by putting that in, I've very quickly been able to put my own stamp on the image. So what have we got? My thought. Oh, wow. Did I show this one already? That was cool. My eyes are ruthless. My eyes are ruthless and open windows to my secrets. I like ruthless a lot. Ruthless and open is a very original combination of words. That's very different. That's really cool. All right, cool. So we've got all these different ideas. All right. We say the eyes are something else. The thoughts are something else. Other things you can do this with that I think are really effective is like the mind, the heart. If ever you're talking, you're describing a piece and you're talking about, let's say you're talking about a gunman, right, standing on top of a building, an assassin, and he's trying to assassinate someone who's like who's walking underneath, and that's the start of your short story, right? Focusing on zooming in on the eyes of that assassin, saying his eyes were, I mean, the obvious thing I immediately think of is bullets. So is there a way I can make that more unusual, more interesting, more different? But what can you say that his eyes are? And actually, remembering that eyes are the windows to the soul, if you have a character, a lot of hardball detective fiction used to do this, focusing on metaphors for the eyes can be really, really effective. Adam, you're a minger, but I like it. My mouth is a fountain of saliva. Absolutely. Oh gosh, do you know what? We've got to stop for a second. These are fantastic. The books left in the rain were mushy like a puree. Great, this is cool. This is a type of metaphor because it's a simile because we've got the word like in it. You could still reduce it even more. You could say the books left in the rain were just a puree. Now you could say that if you'd like to, or were tomato puree. You could say if you'd already flagged with some foreshadowing that it was a red book. You've got my eyes are the lens of my imagination. This is great. The books left in the rain were weeping, ink spilling and seeping onto the wet ground. Weeping is really interesting. That is a form of metaphor we're going to get to in a bit. That's great. So we've got our straightforward, clear, crisp kind of metaphors that we're working on. And remember, as we're developing these, the key is this. It really is this. It's that originality. Can we push for a little bit of originality? I show this when I work in schools a lot, when I work in secondaries. So let's see if I can bring this up in a way you can see it. All right, cool. So I think a really good metaphor, like I think all of our writing when we're writing metaphors exists on this line, right? Now, I think you have some pretty bad metaphors sometimes, like cliche. If we come up with kind of the opposite of originality, and cliche is when we just say things that everyone says, it's the same old stuff, and it's kind of a bit boring and it's not very interesting. You might say like, as a simile that would be pretty boring would be, he went as pale as a sheep or as white as a ghost. Yeah. Those things are kind of very cliche. We've heard these metaphors and these similes an awful lot in our lives. And if we end up putting our ideas in here, they are not worth very much to us, right? Pretty boring. No one really cares. If you're using the same ideas as everyone else, up here, you've got original metaphors, exciting, weird stuff. For example, this is a nice simile. My pulse was quicker than a tidal wave. Nice. I really like it. That's really, really effective. I really like my mouth as a fountain of saliva. This is really cool. These are more original. They're unusual. It's less likely other people have done the same thing. There is a problem if you go all the way to the far end on this line. All right. We're not going cliche, but our ideas are like, here, maybe they're landing here on the line. If you end up landing here, like they're so original that they're up the far end, the problem with this is it's kind of, my handwriting is really bad. They're kind of weird, right? This is kind of weird and unusual. And if we go too far, we lose our audience. For example, let's say we're writing our original metaphors and our original ideas, and some people are writing some really interesting kind of cool ones, and I start going, do you know what? They're using words for their metaphors. I'm going to be even more original. I'm just going to use like words that don't even exist or just burp words. And it's going to be really, that's super original. And you go down this end and then people kind of go, what's he saying? And I'm just like going burp, burp, burp. And they're like, I don't understand what the metaphor is. Now, I think the thing that stops us going too far with the metaphor is this word. It's truth. Has to be some element of truth somewhere within the metaphor for us to be able to get it. I think if we start to move out of this truth and we start to struggle to see where the truth is, it gets a little bit tricky for us to connect. So this is the sweet spot, landing here. All right, original, but not so original. and so unusual that the audience can't understand what we're talking about. For example, these are really good. Cool. My eyes are an ocean with waves spilling out. What I like about this is I associate the eyes with being with tears and with water. So straight away, there's some truth in this kind of moisture and ocean and waves, everything else that's great. If, for example, I was going to say my eyes are sausage rolls freshly out the oven, it's harder for me to work out where the truth is within the metaphor, what links that tenor and that vehicle effectively, right? It gets a bit confusing. Just like if I say like the sun is a beef burger, I can see a truth because of the shape and the roundness. If I said the sun is a sausage, I'd be like, ooh, okay, we're moving into this area. Now this area here, I class as kind of the avant-garde. That's kind of, I suppose, what we could call it within literature. So you can definitely write unusual, weird metaphors that people struggle to understand. But if you can find some truth in your original ideas so people can grasp on the truth, that's really powerful. And that's what ties it in and makes it make sense. So the problem we get if we go too far down the cliche, you know, we have the bad side of metaphor. We get what we call dead metaphors. Right now, over time, these are metaphors that like we've used so much that they don't really even mean a metaphor anymore. We don't even think of them as being as a metaphor. So, for example, the wings of a plane, but the plane doesn't have wings. A bird or a creature has wings. And when that was first being used, wings of a plane was a metaphor. Nowadays, we just think that that's a factual statement that a plane has wings, right? That a chair has legs. Right? It doesn't literally have legs. It has wooden bits at the bottom of it. But we used a metaphor to explain what those bits were. And so now it's called a dead metaphor because we don't really even think about it being metaphor anymore, right? The eye of a needle, also the same thing. The needle doesn't literally have an eye, but we used a metaphor to describe that thing. And over time, it was such a clear statement that these things have become dead. Now, we don't have to worry about dead metaphors, but we do have to worry about dying ones. Now, dying metaphors are when we have metaphors that are really cliche, that bottom end of being pretty dull, all right? So, like, for example, I didn't trust him. I knew there was a snake in the grass, right? Now, that term, snake in the grass, has been used so much that in our writing, if you put it in, I don't think it's going to do very much for you. Certainly if you're sat here thinking about like GCSEs and stuff like that, I would really avoid dying metaphors. Any metaphor that you've heard a lot that's quite popular. I just won the lottery. I'm over the moon about it. I mean, these things are things we use all the time, right? And I've definitely said some of these things in regular conversation. But when we're writing creatively, these things are not helpful, right? These dying metaphors, they're not really going to help us be original and stand out. We couldn't go outside because of the weather. It was raining cats and dogs. Yeah, I mean, if you put it's raining cats and dogs in your original writing exam questions, it's not enough, is it? Like we're doing the opposite of being original. We're right down that far end. A leg has chairs, someone said. Okay, so here we go. I'm going to give you these dying metaphors and I'm going to ask you to bring them back to life. All right, we've got three things here. We've got, I didn't trust him. Now here we had, I knew there was a snake in the grass, but what could you say? What could you say? Maybe there's another type of animal or another type of creature or another thing you could say that he was that is either unreliable or dangerous or not to be trusted, right? There, maybe there's some other things you can come up with. Maybe there's something about him that's like broken or wrong or at fault. Maybe we can come up with something that is more exciting than that dying metaphor, right? We're going to go have a much better metaphor. I just won the lottery. What can you say? Can you come up with a metaphor or a simile that's going to really, really kind of wow us in how it's original? And then this one, we couldn't go outside because of the weather. It was... Now, this is the big challenge. What could you say in relation to the weather that is not raining cats and dogs, that is not a dying metaphor, but is the opposite end? All right. And remember, as we do this, get some truth in. You need some truth in there so that when I, you can't just like have some completely random combinations of words or it won't connect with the reader in the right way. It has to be original, but some truth. I'm going to give you 1 minute. All right. I'll put a bit of music on. See how you do. What do you think? I mean, it's not a metaphor, but I think that's really funny. I didn't trust him. I'd seen his DBS as a factual statement, but it's quite funny. I like it a lot. Very good. But what could you say his DBS was as dodgy as, or as bad as, or his DBS was a what? Sometimes I try to think about this as being like hard-boiled. In hard-boiled detective fiction, they really are like overly dramatic about how they wanted to kind of describe things. They're kind of always suspicious of everything, and they kind of come up with turns of phrase that sound pretty cool. Oh, Callum. I'm just going to put that up because that's badass. I didn't trust him. I knew he was a medieval thane unjustly eyeing the throne. Fantastic. Now, as long as that is not Macbeth that you're literally talking about, and that someone nowadays that is not a medieval thane, that is a brilliant metaphor. Because you're saying that he, the tenor, is the vehicle of a medieval thane. Fantastic. Really original. Oh, I didn't trust him. I knew there was a hornet in the hive. Really nice. Yeah, really, really nice. That I would love to read that in a piece of writing. Ooh. I didn't trust him. I knew he was born from the devil's seed. I mean, that's fantastic. I like it. Aoife, I didn't trust him. He was as sly. We got the start of that. As sly as what? Great, great, great. What can you say he's as sly as? Remember, it's a simile, which is part of the metaphor family, but it's still really, really powerful. He was as sly as what? You guys are doing really well, by the way. I'll give you a bit more time. Keep on working on them. What can you say for the others? What can you say you're happy as? I feel like I'm about to explode. I feel like I'd be over the moon. I feel like I would be kind of buzzing. I would be electric. I would be something about myself that I need to be more than just a human being at this point. What can I be? What do you think of that's exciting, that's uncontrollable, that is powerful? And then he couldn't go outside because of the weather. It was. That's the really hard one. But you know what as well? If you can nail this one, we love talking about the weather in this country. So like that's the kind of thing you can get. You can have a really nice original metaphor for bad weather in the UK. That's probably about 80% of your conversations with random passers-by completely sorted from now on. Oh, fantastic, fantastic. 30 seconds left. I'll give you 30 seconds. Okay, I think that's plenty of time. Don't worry if we didn't get them all done. The important thing with this is that we're learning about them as we go, all right? So we've got these kind of, we've had these dying metaphors, didn't we? These metaphors that are not really working anymore, and we're going to breathe life into them. We're going to make them effective working metaphors that are original. So we've got, let's go up here. Wow. We've had some great ones for trust him. All right, I like this one. So I didn't trust him. I knew his browser history deleted itself. That's like a kind of, that feels like you're making a statement really about, I don't know. No, actually, I think there is kind of some metaphor in there. I think if you could say I didn't trust him, he was a browser history that deleted itself or something, or he felt like, but I think you've kind of have fitted it. I think it does work, and I like the image a lot. It makes me laugh. What have we got here? I can only read the first part, but I didn't trust him. I knew he was just another one of those snakes Taylor Swift often sang about in her videos. Look what you made me do, he'd often say to me. Okay, yeah, okay, just popped into your brain. Not a Taylor Swift fan, don't worry about it, Irina. That's cool. I think what you're doing is you're really drawing and stuff. I think that's a great idea. I think you could reduce it slightly. I didn't trust him. He was just another one of those snakes Taylor Swift sings about, you could say, and that would be it, just kind of connecting slightly. But it's a great original idea. I didn't trust him. There was a mole hill around the corner. Ooh, nice. I like it. I'm a balloon, overinflated with joy. Fantastic. I love that you didn't just say I'm a balloon, right? But you've really kind of extended that metaphor and you've added more description into it. That's great. Now, as soon as you've said this, immediately I am more interested in your writing. I feel that you are, you're putting images into my head that are more powerful, and you're more likely, if you can start a piece of descriptive writing in your GCSE exam with a decent metaphor, just chuck one straight in, the examiner immediately just kind of sits back and goes, oh, this person knows how to guide me through the writing. They've got a strong eye for this. So we couldn't go outside because of the weather. It was a raging waterfall engulfing our souls. Woo, Natasha, amazing, lovely piece. Or it's a side thing. I often talk more to Key Stage 5 about this. Careful with the word souls. It's a very powerful and abstract thing because we can't really see a soul or touch a soul or anything. It's quite difficult sometimes for a reader to connect with it when it's put into a piece of writing. And so what you've got is a very complex, exciting piece of writing, but the last word is souls. And it just makes it quite overwhelming towards the end. I think it's a really, really cool idea, but just to always be aware that certain words that we like, souls, that are very powerful and difficult to picture, can be a lot for a reader to take in. But that's cool. We couldn't go outside because of the weather. It was a raging war. Oh, sorry, I've said that. I just won the lottery. I'm happier than the first time parent when their child is born. Okay, great. Yeah, great. Again, another really good simile. We're using like Dan. I just won the lottery. Oh, wow, I'm a proton about to crack this atomic shell. Yeah, all right, that's cool. I like it. I'm drunk with relief. Nice. Really nice. Jill, what I love about this is very tight. You haven't used much space on the page to put this down, and it's a really powerful image. Shipwreck shaking with terror. I didn't trust him. I knew he was a hawk hovering ominously above, waiting for me to slip. Nice. Now, I think that's a really cool line if you are talking about maybe like a work colleague or something, but certainly something that is far removed from the environment you're talking about. It's cool. Oh, nice. We couldn't go outside because of the weather. It was an almighty atmospheric Armageddon out there. Yeah, great. I love it. I love your alliteration as we're going through at the beginning of those words as well. That's great. Okay, cool. All right, so we've breathed some life into these metaphors and we've fixed these kind of dying metaphors. I want to talk to you about implied metaphors. They're a different type of metaphor as well. So far we've had simile. We're just going to go with metaphor then for our second one. There's like a bunch of them, but we only have so long today. We've got implied metaphors. We've had dead metaphors, right? We've got dying. Implied is when so you could say in a piece of writing that Robert is a mule standing his ground, right? We're using the tenor of Robert and we're using the vehicle of mule, right? That's standing its ground. That's what we're saying. We're saying he is a mule standing its ground. Cool. But implied metaphor, we don't do that. What we do is we suggest that he's like a mule by giving him the characteristics or the behaviors of a mule in the piece of writing. So Robert brayed his refusal to leave. And the word brayed is an implied metaphor. We're not saying that he's a mule, but we're giving him a language similar to a mule to suggest his stubbornness and what he's doing. We could have here, Alex, I've given Alex some mule type language here. Alex was chomping at the bit to have her turn, right? So there again, we've got an implied metaphor where we're suggesting that they are this creature, but we're not saying Alex was a mule chomping at the bit, or Robert was a mule braying to be refused to leave. We're saying that they were doing the actions that we associate with those creatures and implying the metaphor through that. It's more subtle. And I think it's quite tricky to get right. But if you can imply that someone is something else or something is something else, that can be very, very powerful. So I'm going to give you two examples of this, and I want you to have a go. See if you can get one of them. My first suggestion is Omar was nervous is your first sentence. All right. And I want you to say, what could he be doing? What could be happening that could be language you'd associate with maybe like something that is nervous? I would suggest like a rabbit or a mouse. What could he be doing? Maybe he's traveling somewhere. How could he be moving that would be in some way suggesting that he was one of these things? You're not going to say that he is a rabbit or he is a mouse, but we're going to suggest that Omar is doing something like these creatures, using some language we'd associate with this to give an implied metaphor. Okay, I'm giving you another one here. Jody was livid. Can you think of like a, maybe an animal? Often it's quite effective to think about an animal that we associate with like anger, rage, danger, fierceness. Is there any language you could use to have her doing something that would feel like that animal? We kind of use that language. Maybe, for example, she'd be beating on her chest, or like, you know, she could be kind of she like swang into the room, like snarling, snarling and banging her chest. For me, that's implying that she's like a gorilla. But what could you get them to do? So whenever we're kind of doing those things, we're implying our metaphors. These are really nice and they're very quick. If you can like sneak them in as we're going. So I'm going to give you 1 minute. Have a go. What can you say? Omar was nervous. He, what can you have him do? Jody was livid. She or her, what can you have happen there? All right, 1 minute, off you go. Doing really well, by the way. It's I knew when we were going to do this, this was going to be a lot of little bits, all right, and a lot to talk through. But I think it's good to have a refresher and realize that metaphors, there's a lot going on that we can use as metaphors. Ooh. These are great. Nice quick ones here. All right, cool. We've got some nice quick ones. We'll give it like 10 seconds more. You guys are really good. Really, really good. All right, we got a load of cool ideas. Okay, fantastic. So as we go through these, what have we got? We've got Omar. Nice, straight away. Was nervous, scurrying around the room. Great. Really quick, easy one. The thing that we get that's tricky, and we have to think about this with our metaphors, it's tricky sometimes with these implied things. Other people can think about the same things. Absolutely. That's one of the first things I would think about as well. So we might want to kind of think about an extra word we can place in somewhere so we don't just get like, so we go beyond just scurrying or how we can make that really kind of stick out. But absolutely, I think there's a really, really good clear word to start with. Okay, like this, Jody was livid. She charged over to the door. Absolutely. Maybe she could snort at the same time. Absolutely. That's a really, really nice one. Was livid. Nails clawing at the chair arm. Absolutely. Now, that is a really, really nice clear thing. Wouldn't normally get someone... That's not what actually happened, right? She didn't actually like claw through the material of the chair arm. But by putting in that additional implied metaphor, it makes her actions seem seem richer and more powerful. We often don't cover implied metaphor and we kind of focus just on the kind of straight up, this thing is this. But if you can thread them in throughout the work, it will really kind of power up what you're doing. Squeaked back at Jody from the safety of his room. Oh man, I feel a bit worried about Omar at the moment. I think Jody's really kicking off. Okay, skittered to the comforting shadow and refuge of his family. Oh, nice. Omar was nervous. His whiskers twitched feverishly. I like the idea of the whiskers, because he hasn't literally got whiskers, but why not put them on? That's a really interesting image. I think it's like we're edging into a slightly more avant-garde thing because you can't see them, but I don't think it is fully avant-garde. I think that's a really cool, exciting idea. Omar was nervous. He'd freeze momentarily, then dart to the other side of the room, eyes twitching. Nice. Now, we've got the freezing momentarily, darting to the other side of the room, and the eyes twitching are three different small implied metaphors that suggest that he is this small animal as he's running. And straight away, I am kind of more invested in Omar as a character now. You've really kind of painted him in a way that makes it seem more vivid, and I like it. So Jill, that's a really great sentence there. Wow, nice. Jodie was livid, mauling trees with her every word. Nice, I like that a lot. Jodie was livid, growling at those she suspected of using the last of the toilet roll. Whoa. Absolutely. I think growling is nice. She allowed a growl. I like she allowed, because that really suggests that she is very powerful, right? And she's kind of very much in control. She allowed a growl to slip between her clenched fangs. That also suggests that she's kind of at war internally, but there's another power within her. Like there's her, and then there's where there's a growl is coming from, and it's competing. Callum has a really cool line. Her teeth were gritted. She was erupting on the inside. Yeah, great, great. Gritted. And she was erupting. Yeah, this kind of volcanic feeling that we've got. Great. Guys, you're smashing it. We got this one here. She roared with anger. Who stole her fudge bars? The debate was a fiery outrage. Great. All perfect. So these are these are great. These implied metaphors that we can thread throughout our piece of work. And when we're writing things descriptively, think about that. If you're sat in an exam and you're writing for AQA, question 5 on paper 1, and you're writing your descriptive piece about a character moving into a room, maybe they're quite low status, or maybe they're quite high status. Maybe they're angry, or maybe they're quite meek. If you can think of like an animal or a creature that you can thread that language into that character throughout that piece of descriptive writing, that'll be really powerful and a really engaging thing for you to do. I would definitely encourage you to think about those kind of implied metaphors. Right, next form of metaphor, personification. We're down to our final two, guys, and we're out. So personification. Personification is when we give something that is not a human being like human-like qualities. So here we've got a bunch of words. I would suggest that these words are all like really, really useful when we're thinking about personifying things. We could say, for example, these are all things that people do, right? So we could say like we whisper, we might dance, we devour, we lean, we protest, we salute, we stand, we hum. And I've done some past present tense and past tense kind of words here, just a mix of stuff. But I think sometimes it's good to just think of like all the different words we associate with our actions and with people. And these words here, I think if you think about a bunch of these and you've got a bunch of these on lock, feel free to write any of them down if you'd like to. They help us come up with personification. So we need to find for this a tenor, which is the tenor is going to be something that is not a human being. And then our vehicle is going to be, we're going to be implying a metaphor through this personified language, right? And we're going to be, the vehicle is going to be that they are a person. So can you finish these sentences? The wind. Now, you can use any of these words. I don't want you to just use one. See what you can add into it. But we're trying to give it this, the qualities that suggest that these things are like a person somehow, or some qualities in relation to a person. So we've got the wind. What happens with the wind? Now, there's loads of things. I'm going to straight away say whispered, right? You can straight away, as soon as you say the wind whispered through the trees, I think that's quite it's quite a cliched form of personification, I would say. But what can you say the wind did? We've got lots of choices here. What are you going to say that did? And it's going to have the qualities where we've made, given the wind, these kind of personal, human-like qualities. The decrepit house, what will happen? If you want to change any of these slightly, do that as well. That's totally cool. And the police sirens. Can you finish that sentence? Tenor. Absolutely. I'm going to put that. Tenor plus vehicle equals metaphor. Exactly, exactly. So the tenor is going to be that wind, the decrepit house, or the police sirens. And the vehicle, in this case, personification, the vehicle is a person, right? We're going to say it's like a person. So we're going to use these different things. You guys are so good. These are some complex stuff. All right. 1 minute. See what you can come up with. You're doing really well. We've only got one more after this, all right? You are nearly done. These are really good. These are really good. Keep on going. We've got a few people who got the first one down. We're into the decrepit house. Police sirens are the hardest. I often try and put the hardest one at the end. See how you can do. But see how we can kind of get these ideas in. And I hope as you're doing this, you can see metaphor is one of the best ways of really just leveling up our writing, really kind of making it seem richer and more powerful. These words are always good words to use in relation to personifying things. And notice, this is quite easy. I think it's quite easy when we know we've got these words locked down. Okay, all right. You guys are ace. So we got, I mean, by all means, kind of carry on having a go. If you're finishing one, bring it to the end. We're going to kind of have a little look at what we got. So we've got... the wind was smashing into the walls and windows. You could even have the wind was like pounding its fists into the walls and windows. You could even say that, and suddenly we're given the wind like fists, right, and arms. That's great. We've got the wind devoured the seaside, eating up grains of sand. Two sentences on the wind there, and I think that is a really engaging, powerful way to write about the wind that makes me interested and has me completely immersed within the writing. That's great. The wind howled, finally free from its prison. Nice. So, yeah, we put people in prisons, right? So by putting the prison there, you've extended this personification in there. That's great. The wind whispered silently. The trees echoed its sound. The wind rushed through the treetops. The decrepit house divides me a tasty snack. Absolutely. I could picture like a really creepy, we did the gothic horror piece session, didn't we? And these decrepit houses being like people is really interesting. The wind crumbling its ancient supports, the decrepit house groaned. Groaned is great as well because we've got like a sound that's really clear within there. The wind... Callum, you keep pushing it a little bit further, Callum. I like it. The wind uttered sweet nothings to each other and every tree it brushed against. Nice. Whispering sweet nothings is a really nice original way of taking this personification. The police sirens danced among the riots is really interesting use of personification because that's a very... We don't associate riots with dancing, right? That feels very very much juxtaposed when two opposite things are colliding with each other in a sentence. And that's really exciting and really valuable for us as a writer. Very original as well. Well done. The wind slapped at my legs. I walked towards the shoreline. I hope you can feel that we're getting better, right? Even within this workshop, we're kind of like mining better stuff as a writer. Strangers next searching for a companion. Yep, absolutely. Decrepit protest against the decrepit building house protested against the weight of the footsteps. Oh, it's protesting against the weight of your footsteps. You've said instead of just it groaned or it kind of like creaked, you've talked about it protesting against the footsteps. That is really interesting, and that gives a real strength and power to what you're writing about. Okay, the police sirens howled through the streets, signaling something was wrong. Great, cool, nice, clear. Ooh, the police sirens butchered the silence the village revered. Oh, lovely. The word butchered straight away is a very, very powerful, very interesting form of personification. But we've got it, right? So again, we're now seeing, aren't we? Metaphor is like a huge family of different terms. And it's always when we take one thing, the tenor, and we the vehicle, and we bring those things together somehow. Fantastic. So we've got personification. Final one. Most ambitious one. The extended metaphor. Now, this is where we take a metaphor or an idea. You're already starting to do it, some of you guys, in your ideas. So, for example, I've got a metaphor here. Mum is such a bear in the mornings. And I could just end it there, right? That would be my metaphor. But if I extend the metaphor, it means I'm continuing with more sentences and I'm going to continue exploring the same metaphor. And I'm going to give reasons why she is a bear in the mornings. All right, so I start kind of continuing this piece of writing. Now, an extended metaphor, often within poetry, it's kind of it's sometimes seen as a way of like showing off a bit. You know, like you might start by going, "My heart is a dripping candle," right? You might start with that, but then you stay talking about why it's a candle. Maybe you kind of talk about being made of wax. Maybe it's kind of running lower, and the hotter it gets, the less reserves you have there for other people. It can only focus on one thing at a time. I don't know, but you could keep talking about that metaphor for an entire poem, and that's what you're really focusing on. Extended metaphor, I think in our descriptive writing, we're probably not going to have much room for it, but I think it's worth bearing in mind that this is where you can really take it. This is my first suggestion. Can you give me how you could extend this metaphor? Oh, oops, typo there. Mum is such a bear in the mornings. She, how would you extend that? We've got, oh, okay, so great. We've got some, we've extended the metaphor by giving some kind of, my mum is such a bear in the mornings. Her stomach groans and growls, waiting to devour its meal. Like the way we're getting that word devouring. Nice, nice, nice. Absolutely. You've extended the metaphor there. Can you extend it then even further? So you've got this idea of her there, but can you keep going? And as we extend the metaphor, we try and have as much writing as we can looking at the same thing. I'm going to give you like 30 seconds to see what you can come up with on this. This is pretty much it, guys. We're pretty much out now. What can you do? How can you extend that metaphor? Really push yourself. What can you say? Why is she like a bear in the mornings? See if you can make me laugh. All right, let's see how are we doing. Oh, we still getting a bit more time. Mum is such a bear in the morning. These are really good. All right, we're kind of running low on time, so we're going to try and keep this quick. All right, I got two. Okay, my mum is such a bear in the morning. She stumbles and staggers until the first feed. Yeah, absolutely. She marches around the house, ruining the peacefulness of sleep, giving out orders to clean and clear our room and make breakfast. Mom is such a bear in the mornings. Notice how we can repeat that line in a poem and keep coming back to it. It's kind of fun. She scratches the couch with her back, her behind nestling into the cracks. Mom is such a bear in the mornings. Bear in the morning. She growls if anyone tries to touch her breakfast porridge. Mom is such a bear in the morning. She slumps her way step by step downstairs before pouring the cereal into the bowl. Mum is such a bear in the mornings, wrestling with the arm of her dressing gown like a salmon from the river. This is great. Mum is such a bear in the mornings. Her mundane voice, oh, that's mean. Mundane voice bellows throughout the house, startling me at my most peaceful moments. Now, You don't have to do the repeated line, but notice, you can just have an entire poem that is a repeated line like that, and then keep jumping off as you keep extending the same metaphor. Another thing you could do is you could focus on an entire family, right? Because my family is a toolbox. My father is a, what item in the toolbox would you say your father is? And then you extend that and say, why is he that item? All right, my mother is a what? What is she from the toolbox? And where would you go from that? This is going to be the absolute last task. All right, we're going to try both of these. My family's a toolbox. My father is a what? What can you say he is within that toolbox? Bear in mind, there's only so many things in a toolbox. So how are you going to enrich the writing and make it original so that you're not going to have the same writing as anybody else? My father is a what? Always, as we extend the metaphor, right? My father is a, I might say he's a hammer. Always knocking us into shape. My mother is a, what could you say there for your mother? Another item within the toolbox. I'm going to give you 1 minute, 1 minute, and we'll see what we've got. And then that is going to be the close of our workshop. Okay, so we've got our tenors, which is father and mother. And we know, don't we, that our vehicles are going to be items within the toolbox. Here we go, guys. Gonna bring it home. Your final task for the day. See what we get. I've been so impressed, really impressed with you guys today. It's been an absolute treat working with you all. I know there was a lot to go through at the beginning to get our heads around it, but you producing, I can see the improvement in your ideas as we're going through. Okay. See what we can get. 10 more seconds. 10 more seconds. All right. All right. All right. All right. Here we go. Here we go. So we got, here we go. Let's have a look. Okay. So to finish up our metaphors, we've covered a lot of metaphors today. Let's have a look at these extended metaphors. Oh, I like this. You randomly got this wolf one that I think is great. Well done, Brandon. That's cool. All right. So we've got my family is a toolbox. My father is a rubber mallet. Oh, gosh. Always threatening violence, but with a softer hit. My mother is a nail. Small, sharp, but ultimately safe. Like, nice. I like it. Really lovely extended metaphor there. We've got my family is a toolbox. My father is a ruler, carefully measuring every situation. My mother is a wrench, always fixing my father's horrible planning. Karen, that's fantastic. Jordan, my family is a toolbox. My father is a spanner, always making jokes. I love it. My mother is a hammer, waking up the whole family with her yammer. I like the rhyming you're putting in. Jordan, that is fantastic work. Well done. Adam, we got my mother is a hammer, always banging on to me. Yeah, okay. Yeah, I definitely can sympathize with that. My father is a Swiss Army knife, always trying to fix every situation. Really clever. My father is a toolbox. My family is a toolbox. My father is a tape measure, pushing us to go further whilst towering over us. My mother is a hammer, a force to be reckoned with, keeping us in line. My father is a drill, always screwing around. My family is a toolbox. My father is a hammer, relentlessly banging on about something, usually the noise the neighbors make. Fantastic. Right, guys. You are capable, right, of doing all of this stuff. By the end of this session, you're coming out with rich, complex metaphors that are not the same as anyone else's. We're keeping that originality. And that is really, if you can remember, that's really what I want you to remember more than anything else. The originality. That's what really makes your metaphors pop. we went over similes, didn't we? That's part of the metaphor families. We went over kind of straightforward, just the metaphors. We went over dead metaphors, which are kind of metaphors that we don't even realize are metaphors anymore. And we went to dying metaphors, which are really cliched, boring stuff. We reinvigorated those. We had a look at implied metaphors. You did really well on that. We looked at personification and we looked at extended metaphors. You guys smashed it every single time. Your final task is today. If you want to take this further in your own piece of writing at some point today, anything you send over to me, I will definitely give you feedback on. I'm trying to record little video feedback when I can, because I think that's kind of most fun for you guys. It might take me 1 or 2 days to get back because I'm getting quite a few messages at the moment. But if you do complete this, have a go at this as a further task. Can you use, can you write, I was going to have 3 examples, we'll just go with 1. Can you write an extended metaphor or poem or piece of writing? I want you to write a piece that starts with, sometimes the world seems like what? What can you say that the world seems like? We've got a simile straight away at the beginning there. What can you say the world seems like? I think at the moment, this world, there's a lot going on. There's a lot to take in and it's really quite overwhelming at times. And I think if you can put a spin on this, and come up with an extended metaphor for what the world seems like to you. We can't use toolbox because it's kind of gone already, but what could you say it's like? And how could you extend that metaphor? And could you write a piece of poetry where you really explore that, or a piece of writing where you explore it? I think a good challenge, good target is about 12 lines. If anyone does that and can get that done, I'll be so amazed. Feel free to send it over. But anything you come up with, feel free to send it over as well. Like, I'm always happy to like give you feedback and let you know how things are going. That is metaphors. You are metaphor experts. Please remember all those tricks and all those ideas and kind of make sure you put them into writing. Next week, we might have a look at rap. I'm kind of itching to do some stuff on rhyme and playing about with rap. So that's what we'll kind of focus on. Cool. Well done. Oh, last thing to go out on. Sometimes the world seems like an experiment, a big yellow eye staring down on us, examining any move we make. I don't see why that is any less exciting or powerful an opening line for a poem than anything I would hear at a poetry slam, a poetry event. You got the start of a really cool poem there. Well done, Brandon. All right, cool. Guys, I'm going to go. You've been amazing. Remember the metaphors. There's a bunch of them. Any questions, send them over. Any work you complete, send it over as well, and I'll get back to you. Have a good one. It's been an absolute pleasure to work with you. You are so